Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Firstly, let me just apologize for the background noise. You might hear some magpies out there. There are bunnies hopping around. There might be some traffic or some boats even. We're hanging out at the Colorado State Parks for a little while by the lake. It's absolutely beautiful, but it's a little bit more noisy, so I apologize in advance if you hear something in the background, whether it's man-made or bird-made. It's a great place to be. Lots of energy here. But I want to ask you, when was the last time you had a proper bone broth soup? You know, the slow-cooked kind that gets you all the old-fashioned real food vitamins, minerals, and goodness out of big old bones and joints. Well, thankfully, getting your broth on doesn't have to mean stinking up your kitchen or garage with boiling oxtails and chicken feet. In the past few years, we've found innovative ways to get the nutrition of bone broth into foods that can be a lot more convenient and fun to eat. So today we're here with Melissa Boloña, an actress and entrepreneur who created Beauty and the Broth. But before we get there, here's a note that came in from Jean, who says, "I absolutely love the recipes in your books. I started 6 days ago and I'm down 5 pounds. I have not had a grain of wheat. I'm not bloated and my joints don't hurt so much. I am making a recipe a night. Hubby is helping pick them out. So yummy. Can't wait to see what the next week does. Thanks, Jean." Jean, thank you so much for writing in. Absolutely. When you kick modern wheat out of your diet, oftentimes you'll notice a lot of improvements. I'm glad you're having such a good experience so far. Yes, absolutely. When people kick out modern wheat, especially if you haven't done it in a while or ever, you can notice a lot of differences right away, whether it's your joints being a little less achy or some puffiness going away, or just your energy starts getting a little less draggy, and those down points in the day might not be so bad if you haven't slammed a bunch of spaghetti or, you know, a bunch of bread in your Subway hoagie or whatever it was. When you kick out all of the flours and the baked goods and the industrial oils, it can really add up to some major differences, especially over time. But I'm really glad, Jean, that you're already noticing that these positive things are happening in your body. It's, you know, easier said than done staying away from modern wheat and industrial oils. Trust me, we understand. We have lived on the road on and off for many, many years, on and off for a decade, really. And it can be very difficult in some parts of the country and the world to get fresh, real foods. So you do the best you can. Coloring outside the lines every once in a while and having a bit of pizza or a bit of cake is not the end of the world. So it doesn't have to be a life sentence. But if you're able to get down the amount of these horrific foods that really do cause trouble in quantities to our bodies, if you're able to turn that down a little bit, your body will thank you and you'll notice it. So good on you, Jean, for doing just that. And if you all would like some of our free recipes, or you'd like our quick start guide, some audio courses, and much, much more, visit us over at fatburningman.com. And if you'd like to support this free show, please head on over to wildsuperfoods.com. That's our family company, and you can grab all of our favorite go-to supplements that we take just about every day, including Future Greens, a concentrated fruit and veg mix that's great for families, Vitamin D Stack, Fizzy C, Collagen Cocoa, Mega Omegas, Probiotic Spheres, some special bundles put together, and Subscribe and Save to make these really high-quality supplements much more affordable. And if you'd like a bit of a discount to dip your toes in and try Wild Superfoods for the first time, whether it's Future Greens or Collagen Cocoa or anything else, then use the code WILD15 for 15% off your first order. That's WILD15 for 15% off anything or everything you get from wildsuperfoods.com. Right now, we're only in the United States of America, but every purchase directly supports our work, and you get real food supplements that we spent years looking for and have been taking for many years now. And when you're on the road, especially, you can notice how much they save you when you're starting to get that low point of energy. You're just running out of gas. You need something to keep you going. You don't want caffeine. Future Greens or Collagen Cocoa have come in so handy. Collagen Cocoa is great as a last second treat when you mix it in some yogurt. You can take it just in water or a smoothie. There are so many ways to make brownies and ice creams. We have lots of recipes. So if you are interested, please go to wildsuperfoods.com one more time and enter the code WILD15 to save 15% off your first order. And very quickly, before we get to the show with Melissa, if you're interested in blue blocking technology or blue blocking glasses, then please visit our very special project over at wildrx.com. As you may or may not know, we just launched our very own line of blue blocking glasses. It's the same ones that we've been using, you may have seen in some videos over the years. So you can take a look at getting your very own blue blocking glasses from wildrx.com. You can also spend a little time learning more about the science and technology on that website that we put together, and I really hope that you like it. It's made a big difference for us. As you know, Allison and I love gaming from time to time, as we talk about in this show today. We have beat some epic games. I'm not going to spoil it right now, and we're almost done with another one. I'm not going to spoil it, but when you're on your devices, when you're watching TV, especially after dark, it can make a massive difference throwing some blue blockers on. So please visit us over at wildrx.com. Let us know what you think. All right, on to the show with Melissa. We're chatting about why a good broth can raise the dead, how a good old-fashioned bone broth is different from modern cubes of concentrated salt and MSG and other stuff like that, how to get the benefits of bone broth without spending days prepping and cooking, why couch co-op video games can actually be good for relationships, and much more. Let's go hang out with Melissa. All right, thanks for joining us, folks. Today we're here with Melissa Boloña, an entrepreneur as well as the founder and CEO of Beauty and the Broth. Melissa spent years in front of the camera as a model and actress, gracing magazine covers and starring in more than 20 films with the likes of John Travolta, James Franco, Nicolas Cage, Val Kilmer, and Bruce Willis, to name a few. She has worked with the world's best makeup artists and sampled just about every top beauty product out there, yet she still credits bone broth as her number one beauty secret. Thanks so much for being here, Melissa.
Thank you. I'm very excited to talk all things bone broth and all of the secrets.
Well, longtime listeners of this show know that we're giant super fans of bone broth, but there are many people out there who are intrigued and interested. But once they realize that you have to go out and get all these like raw, bloody, meaty bones in a giant crock pot that stinks when you put it in the kitchen, and like all of the, it's kind of a giant charade that's more built for our grandmother's generation in a lot of ways than for ours, where we value convenience and just wanting to get the benefits without all of the work. So what you've done is really interesting, but let's start with how did you get there? How did you find your way to bone broth in particular?
So I was definitely one of those people plus where not only the lack of convenience in making it and handling the bones, but just the word bone broth. I told my sister that I would never try it because I thought it was weird. I'm someone who struggled with really bad digestive issues all my life. I love to tell people that I almost got held back in school because I missed so many days and they could not figure out what was wrong. And it was good old fashioned digestive issues. And it wasn't until I got massively desperate, because to me, health used to be about how I looked. And it wasn't until I got a little older that it became more about how I felt. So I was on set, funny enough, and I just started to feel really inflamed, bloated, just a massive brain fog. So I asked my sister again for help, and she kept pointing me to bone broth. So I broke down and said, fine, I'll try this weird witchcraft. I tried it and I was like, first of all, it doesn't taste how it sounds. It tasted great. And then it was something really easy under the right circumstances. I never made it until I made this company when I was doing research and development. But, you know, it was a very popular thing to grab in New York. So I would just get that as part of my routine. And then when it got rid of my brain fog, which at the time I did not know why, which I know now, I couldn't believe it. And then when it healed my gut, my digestive issues, and then the icing on the cake was seeing my hair, skin, and nails. I'm someone who's gotten Botox, every laser treatment imaginable, and I couldn't believe that this was the thing that made any sort of lines I personally had feel a lot more diminished and cared for. And that's when I went back to Los Angeles and I went to continue my routine of bone broth. And I was shocked to see how limited it was there compared to New York City, where there's a lot of pop-up shops and what have you. So that's where the idea came from. And I knew I needed to make something very convenient because that was the issue I was having in LA. And when I first started this company, I thought that this meant just, you know, making a shop in LA and selling in California. And now we got to what it is now, having bone broth readily available in all 50 states in Canada.
Wow. So for people who aren't super familiar with the process of how it's made, maybe we should cover that in a little more detail. Do you want to do that? Yeah.
I would love to.
It'd be great.
So bone broth, the people who make it, me, and my supply chain, we like to use the biggest, strongest bone of an animal, such as, you know, the marrow, any sort of knuckle, even chicken feet are great because they're really high in collagen. So we like to use the bones that are going to produce the most gelatin. And the magic of bone broth happens over a long cook time. There's no shortcut to make it, which is part of the issue with people making it, because the bones start to break down over a long and slow cook time on a simmer. And, you know, if you just have it on high heat, then you're, you know, not cooking it right. It's not slowly going out into the stew. In fact, it's probably just burning off. So it requires a lot of patience. And then you throw in other great herbs in there that can only increase the benefit, whether it's turmeric and ginger, that's also very anti-inflammatory, or, you know, different herbs like rosemary and thyme. And then you just cook it slowly. And I like to say intact, which means, you know, not kind of cutting up the bone, just, you know, as much ligaments and everything as possible to cook it intact, the better. And then it cooks for, some people do it 17 hours. The best are cooked 24 to 48 hours on a slow simmer. And then that extracts the most benefit from these bones. And that's where the magic of bone broth happens, where all the gelatin, amino acids, and nutrients get released into the broth.
Now, I remember when I was doing that, that TV show with Kurt, who I was coaching down from, he was like 352 pounds at the beginning, and he lost, I think it was 87 pounds over the course of like 4 months. But bone broth was a big piece of what he did. But the problem was, and he was totally into it. Like, he didn't mind that it's a little stinky and weird. He thought the bones was cool. But his wife was just like, that kind of smell, we need to move that out to the garage. And I was like, this takes on a funk. And especially, so we're kind of starting by talking about beef or maybe chicken feet, which sounds like black magic and kind of smells like it too. But fish is even worse, right? Like if you use the fish tails and the fish skeletons or whatever, it's like, that's pretty gnarly. So it is definitely a commitment, not just to do it for the first time, but especially to keep doing it as a staple of your diet, which it really should be. But if you go back in time, we wouldn't have each probably been doing this individually. We more would have been having as a collective stews, and just like as a community, this would have been happening all the time, but not necessarily in every person's house, stinking it up every day. All the time. So we kind of need someone like you or other bone broth companies that are doing the nasty parts of the business, or the ones that, you know, it's really not ideal to have a ton of raw, bloody dog bones essentially on your counter, whether it's before they're a health risk or kind of after, right? They burn through your trash and they stink up the house again when you have to dispose of them.
Totally. It's not ideal. And I've, especially at the beginning of Beauty and the Broth, I've done it more times than I could count. And also, for whatever it's worth, getting it to taste consistent, impossible to do at home. Like if you change, like, I swear, like 0.1 ounce of something, it tastes totally different. Or, you know, the heat changes, and then, you know, you can't be sleeping with your stovetop on unless you want to potentially burn the house down. That was a big issue I ran into. So then you move it to like an electric cooker for overnight. And then when it goes on the electric cooker, it tastes different. So it's a whole thing. So I'm very proud we have a product that's made it super convenient and super clean and also very potent and what I like to consider bougie for bone broth.
Well, it is. And it's it takes out a lot of the tough steps. And maybe you can just fill people in on what you do specifically, because I'd never seen it before. It's, you know, I'd seen bouillon cubes and I'd seen broth that's in containers that are cardboard or in glass that you usually don't have to reconstitute or do much with, or like ready to go. But you rarely see concentrates, especially concentrates that are clean and high in protein.
Yeah. So this is something I'm very proud of. And it's, when I was launching this company, I had no idea about this, obviously. And it came from a series of trial and error. Like I told you at the beginning, I thought I was producing it myself. I had a lease on an offsite kitchen. I interviewed cooks. I knew the recipe inside and out. And then that's when I realized quickly I needed a co-packer. And that was even hard to find, because just like the people sitting at home, not many people want their stove occupied for 24 hours, and neither do these co-packers. Their machinery is occupied for 24 to 48 hours. So it was really hard to find one that A, was willing to make broth, and B, willing to make it to the integrity that I wanted. And of course, USDA organic facilities. So we finally found our home, and it was right before COVID broke out, that January, prior to the March in question, where I visited our co-packers and all of our recipes were locked. And that cup you got that comes in our main boxes, it's like this cool Rice Husk BPA free cup. That was our initial packaging. So initially in my mind, it was going to be reconstituted with water, and not shelf stable. And our business took a big turn in something where it was a risk, because there's definitely an educational process to what this stuff is. And B, something I knew, it was like a major aha moment where I'm like, that is it. That's the disruptor. That's the product. And it sat there on the corner of the table while we were trying my broths in the cups, and it looked like a little hockey puck. And I kept asking, you know, what's that at the corner of the table? Because I was intrigued. It looked like a little round jello hockey puck. And they're like, oh, Melissa, that's just the broth in concentrated format. But don't worry, it's the same thing that's in your cup, except there's also water in it. And I'm just like, okay, well, what's the point of that? They're like, that's how we ship it to the people who package the broth and make it shelf stable, because it's the same exact thing, except we're cooking the water out of it. It's better for shipping and yada, yada, yada. So I'm like, hold on a minute. Like, I've tried a lot of broths on the market, and some of them are really, really weak, and I don't like that. And, you know, some people I use as my guinea pigs would say that they're too strong or too gamey. So people have different palates for this stuff. So when I heard that, I said, why isn't the customer doing that? And the main difference is that it's just kind of even a longer cook time, and it's physically, our product is steamed to get the water out of it. So what you're consuming before you do anything to it, say if you just took it like that, is pure bone broth with the water cooked out of it. So that's called, bone broth is measured in bricks, which is the percentage of solids. And an average cup of bone broth you get at a store or a little shop has 3 to 5 bricks in it. And in that pouch is 25 bricks.
Wow.
So then when you, it's incredible, because then you throw it in the cooking, you have the 25 bricks, you know that, or you put it in a drink like I have, you dilute it with 8 ounces of hot water, and you still have something that's 2.5 times stronger than an average cup of bone broth. So you're really getting the bestest, cleanest, strongest benefits. And then I even went back and forth, because like I said, if I'm just going to leave this acting and modeling life and start a food company, which never in my wildest dreams did I think that would happen.
Yeah,
I truly wanted it to be the best. So I had this misconception of, oh, it has to be fresh. And then when I looked apples to apples with the retort process, which, you know, it's in these pouches that could withstand heat where the temperatures goes slowly, just like the cook time, slowly up and slowly back down, and boom, shelf stable, add zero preservatives to it. Arguably, well, it apples to apples, it's the same. And in my opinion, it gets rid of a lot of bad bacterias, especially when you're going freezer, fridge, in which I had this issue. I would meal prep bone broth where, okay, I'm going away for the weekend, let me take it back to the freezer, and oh, it's been in the fridge 4 days, now it's bad. So that was a big issue too. So I couldn't be more proud of this format. I'll be honest, we kind of fell into from the capabilities of our various supply chains, and from showing up and seeing them in person made all that difference to discover this concentrated format, which is way more easy to integrate in your routine anywhere, on the go, at home, in the gym, the office, even the airplane. So I'm very, very proud of what we were able to accomplish.
It's so interesting. Yeah. And originally I didn't know what to think about concentrates. And especially when I got into this like 10 years ago, like all this, you know, processed stuff is totally full of it and nonsense. And here we are like many years later, and it's literally what we sell in our company. We have powdered concentrated fruits and veggies. We have powdered concentrate bone broth, because I realized that when the rubber hits the road, same, like you have to be a real super fan to put up with all of the food production that goes along with making bone broth, or with making sure that you have shelf stable fruits and greens. We used to all be into canning, right? Like everyone used to go down into their basement and have just this, well, not everyone, but a lot of people, generationally speaking. I know my grandmother's basement was incredible. It was just like a cornucopia of last summer. Right. And she put a lot of work into that, and she had steamed and turned her kitchen into a giant production space or whatever. But these days, one thing that I really appreciated about trying your broth is that a lot of times in the afternoon, I'll want broth, but it turns out I haven't spent the like one day shopping for raw bones and you know, driving back and forth and transporting them, taking them out of the freezer. And just, so I haven't done the 3 or 4 days of prep work that it takes in order to have that quick hit of bone broth that I want, like right now, right in the afternoon.
And totally. So then you're over it.
Yes, totally. And it's also really advantageous to make sure that, you know, when you make that giant bone broth in the crock pot, which is how we typically do it, which solves a lot of problems. You don't have to leave it, you know, on your stove all night or whatever. But at the same time, it's stinking up the kitchen. And then you only get 3 or 4 days tops where it's good. So you have to drink it all real fast. And it's like, maybe I don't want to drink 20 ounces of bone broth right now. You know, you do run into that problem too.
Go through like the process of making it all and getting all the ingredients. You're not doing it just to have 2 cups. So you know, do your kitchen version of mass producing.
Yeah. And it's kind of like coffee in that way. I like to roast my own coffee at home, but I do it for the fun of it. And to be honest, the smells and the experience of taking the green beans and turning that into coffee that's fresh is very enjoyable to me. I do like that, even though it is extra work and I have to blow off the chaff and all this stuff. But when it came to making bone broth, I would put up with it. I never really enjoyed the process of it. And it does feel like you're practicing witchcraft or something. And once again, it smells like that too. But let's talk a little bit more about your experience once you started taking bone broth on a regular basis compared to Botox, or compared to some of these other things that are out there in Hollywood that have all these promises, but they're invasive or a chemical procedure or something like that. What is the difference that was so attractive to you about bone broth in particular?
Oh, it really actually truly felt like witchcraft. And that is not why I took bone broth. And, you know, when I first tried it, I definitely was not. Obviously, now I've learned a ton about bone broth way more than someone should know. But at the time I knew nothing. So I had no idea about any beauty benefits. To me, I'm like, okay, digestive issues, bone broth, got it.
Interesting.
So it's not like I was like looking out for it. I just was like, oh my gosh, like what's happened here? And it was because I was a very smiley kid. So with that, I developed crow's feet. So whenever I smile, I get like the little crow's feet. And when the Botox wears off, I used to be like, oh my gosh, I need to go to the doctor yesterday because it would be back in full force. And I noticed that timer I felt, you know, needing to rush to the doctor went completely away from drinking bone broth routinely. And this is no exaggeration. Me and my sister were having it every single day. At one point, we had to stop taking it for a week and a half, 2 weeks, because this is no joke. Our hair got too thick. This was like a year ago. It got too thick that wow. It was almost like too coarse to do stuff with, because we were like adamant on this routine. You know, I'm a little bit of a girly girl, right? And then I get these, you know, gel tip manicures. Then if you keep growing the nail under it, then you no longer need it. And they use your real nail because it's grown out to the extended tip. And, you know, if you don't have strong nails, you can't even do that because it keeps breaking with constant breakage. It made my nails so strong that once I was able to grow them out safely, it was just my nails is shaped and everything for the manicures, which guys listening, I'm sorry, but who doesn't want strong nails? So those were some real benefits I saw. And in turn, I always like to say good skin comes from the gut, because it truly does. And a volume and stuff I started to see naturally in my face. And whenever I kind of had bad breakouts and would just go back on bone broth and keep it as part of the routine, it came from digestive issues. So it would clear that up right away, which I've had like the blue light lasers, which is also very painful, by the way, for rosacea. And, you know, they promise it will get rid of it. It never got rid of it, by the way. And I'll try any of this stuff. I'm a junkie. And I still couldn't believe that bone broth was the thing that did all this stuff from a beverage, which now I know why, because it literally fills in the holes in your gut and is directly gives you a line to collagen and nutrients.
And how much were you having back then, or how much do you have now?
Back then, a cup every day, a cup or more, because I would either have a cup and then also use it in the base of a soup if I like meal prep during the week. But I definitely strive to have a cup every day.
Yeah. But there's not much benefit necessarily to more than that. Is that true?
You're going to get more protein and more collagen. So there is benefit, but I like to say too much of anything is a bad thing.
Yeah.
People do like to do bone broth fast, and I think that's great. But I wouldn't have more than 5 cups a day. And I really don't think there's any reason to, unless you are using it as meal replacement, which people oftentimes do. Like I typically have I don't have breakfast by nature. Bone broth is my breakfast. So that's what I like to do with it. And of course there's fasters out there. I just am not personally someone who could fast.
Yeah. Well, it works better for some people than others. And bone broth is kind of an interesting one where if you're fasting and you have coffee, for some people, that's not good, right? Like it can rot your guts out from the inside out. Whereas bone broth is almost the opposite effect. And I also find that it doesn't make me want more, if that makes sense. In a good way, it doesn't make me want more. So, right, like once you've had your big old, I'll take this big mug right here, generally. I don't even know how many ounces this is, but it's way more than 8. I don't know, maybe more like 16 or even 20 if you fill it up to the top. And it's like, once I've had that, I might want some more soup or something, or I might want it as a base, you know, to improve the taste of veggies that you're stir frying or used in cooking a little bit here and there. But it's not like I drink it and then I want another cup of it, like a Pepsi or a Coke or like something that makes you want to keep having. It's not like that at all.
Totally. It's not like that at all. And it's definitely something optimal to break a fast because it lines your gut and nourishes it. And what's great about it too, like all, especially after I work out, I get so hungry and I want to eat everything in sight. So I'll have bone broth and then it will save me from myself because it makes you feel nourished. So it curbs your cravings
protein
that you
salt,
have.
Big time.
Yeah. Yeah. So I love that about it too. It saves me from myself.
Yeah. And there aren't many things that do that except for water and boring things, but bone broth, especially, I really want the salt, I find, you know, especially after working out, I'm sure it's the electrolytes, but when you combine the protein, just a slam of 15 or 20 grams of protein with a fair amount of salt, that's enough for me to really, you know, whatever that box was that needed to be ticked off, it is after that. And you don't get the negatives of some of the other. Some supplements have some hairy things in them, post-workout, pre-workout supplements, and a lot of them can upset my stomach, and a lot of people experience that.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And I don't find any supplements out there that literally like nourish you, right? It's like grandma's chicken soup that nourish you and line your gut. Like obviously they serve their own purposes and what have you, but I definitely think bone broth is a great base, no pun intended, and staple.
And versatile in a lot of ways, right? Once you have it around and you know that it's not spoiled or too gamey or whatever, then you can. I love throwing it in stir fries and just kind of combining it with other foods because it does add that like that umami or whatever MSG would typically add to things. It kind of gives you that punch, that kick of glutamate or whatever it is, but not too much all at once. And that's really useful for cooking too.
I love to call it like a cheat code because it gives you, you know, you have to take time seasoning, figuring out or any sort of dressings. And a lot of them have bad stuff in it, where bone broth, boom, it gives you tons of natural flavor. It already has its own herbs in it and what have you. And it just gives your food that extra punch. Like I'll even, this is kind of cool, I like to steam vegetables with it. So I always find that kind of fun.
So when people are going to the grocery store or shopping online and they're looking for bone broth, as you mentioned, there are a lot of them that are weak out there or that are subpar where it's like, oh, pasture raised, grass fed, but totally not. Also, you know, they say it is, but it's totally not. Or they say it's clean or they say it has protein in it or it's good for you. And it's just subpar. So what would you encourage people to look for if they want to find, you know, a broth option? Because there are a lot of bad options out there, it seems.
It's beyond, and I had no idea about this until I got into the industry, but you almost can't even trust the front of the packaging. So it's amazing what you could get away with from a marketing standpoint of claims. So one thing I know, since we're a USDA organic product, like we are regulated, especially the beef. The beef and the chicken are different jurisdictions. The chicken's FDA. So even though I have USDA organic for the chicken, it's still regulated by the FDA. But regardless, having a USDA organic product, you know, it's being regulated and those claims on the packaging better stand true. Otherwise they could get in a lot of trouble and have to recall their whole product, which you would have to be an insane person to do. So I would look out for that. I will say this in all fairness, there are a lot of, I'm like one of like two or three of what I like to consider the biggest bone broth companies who have the beef USDA organic, which is something I'm very proud of. But I've had some dark days, like, you know, stripping a lot of stuff off my packaging, for instance, like Sip Yourself Stunning, like I had to take off the beef packaging. So it's not for beef. I will say like a lot of them just don't want to deal with it. So step two, look out for USDA organic, be a little bit more flexible on the beef, but truly look at the ingredients and nutrition label, because that has to be tested at the lab and everything. And that's where that's the big reveal, because you look at all these claims on the packaging and it's really surprising, not just in bone broth, but different foods. And when you look at the ingredients, you'll really find out. There's some supermarket brands of bone broth that have sugar as an ingredient.
Right, right.
You'll see like xanthan gums and, you know, all this stuff. You just have to really just make sure you recognize all the ingredients. If you don't, definitely Google it, but it's normally a red flag if you can't pronounce the ingredient. And take a look at the protein count, take a look at the sodium count, make sure it's not just like a fluff piece. If it's super high sodium, that's also a red flag. And a lot of bone broths are because of, you know, the cook process and the people adding salt in it additionally. So something that's really important about bone broth is that the bones are reputably sourced, not just because we all love animals. I'm a huge animal fan. We just are top of the food chain. What can I say? So my thing is, obviously I want the animals treated with integrity and love, but also for us, would you want to receive benefits from a stressed out animal? You wouldn't, because you truly are what you eat. So you're not doing much good to your body if you're having bones broken down from an animal who lived a stressful life. You could potentially be doing more harm than good. So that's something really important to make sure that the welfare of the animal, which is another reason why I prefer USDA organic, because it's a whole chain of sequence to get to that point.
Yes. And it gets tricky because technically even industrial raised beef cattle can be called grass fed legally, but it's not grass finished, or there are some things to worry about there. And especially with broth in particular, you're concentrating everything. So if you're taking the bones from an animal that's been pumped full of hormones and antibiotics and has heavy metals that were introduced through the feed or the environment or whatever it was, then that becomes problematic if you're sourcing these low quality bones and having them over a long period of time, especially as something where you're taking a cup a day or whatever. Those sorts of things add up for the daily staples. And that's when it's really important to be super clean about it. Whereas like you're probably familiar with Rob Wolf's recent work looking into grass-fed cattle versus industrial raised. And when it comes to muscle meat, it might not be as much of a concern. But when you look at the fat and the bones and concentrating them especially, you really want to make it as clean as possible. And you want to make sure that whomever you're buying it from isn't lying to you about that.
Totally. No, it's all very, very important. And now we're probably scaring people from looking at the shelves. But, you know, USDA Organic, check out the company, check out the reviews, the ingredients, the nutrient labels, the sourcing as much as you can. And like you say, traceability is important. And you know, also, you know, like we said before, too much of anything is a bad thing. Just have it responsibly. Big fan of once a day, you know, technically twice a day. But don't go crazy on it. People see results, or they like how it curbs their appetite and they want a lot of it. And it's fine to like a bone broth fast, but you know, I'm not a doctor, so consult your doctor. And you know, don't do it all the time.
And it doesn't happen all at once. You know, if you, it's not like if you ate this giant container of protein powder, you just build a bunch of muscle and heal your gut. Like, that's not how it works at all. When you're talking about the gut in particular, or healing from the inside out, it really is about a little bit over the course of, you know, every day or most days over a long period of time. That's when you really see the big results.
Absolutely. No, that's, people say 20 days of a routine of anything to kind of see the results. I personally saw it in 2 weeks, but everyone is completely different of how their body absorbs things.
If you're deficient, then your body will be like, yes, this. And there's something, I know that happened to me like when I first got into it. In fact, yeah, I think one of the first times I had it, especially outside of my own family's house or outside of our own house, was I was on tour playing music with a group in like South Texas, like middle of nowhere. And we were like going and playing all these shows on the coast. And it was a great time, but too great of a time. You know, we were hungover every day. And so we went to one of my friends and his, I think his mother was from Mexico, and she was making this like traditional base of a bone broth. And she just had this giant thing in the kitchen, and she insisted and forced every single member of the band to just like chug all of this bone broth. And we had another round of shows to play that night, but we were running ragged and we were low on sleep and hungover and feeling terrible. And that was like the best show of our lives that night. We like came back to life. We're like, I don't know what this is, but I feel invincible. And we were even less hungover the day following. And so I became a huge fan after that experience. And I think it was some combination of coating our beat up inside of our bellies with exactly, you know, all the holes that we had poked through with the terrible food and the terrible drinks for all those weeks were partially repaired, at least a little bit right away. And our body, it was like a switch that went off, and we all talked about it. We're just like, this is the best. I don't know how we've been missing out on this our whole lives.
So funny. That's hilarious. I mean, yeah, not for nothing, but it is a great hangover cure as well.
I haven't found one that's, I mean, getting some coffee in you maybe, but it'll probably make you feel worse as much as it makes you feel better, right? Like if you are running ragged and then you start hitting the caffeine or something that's like overly acidic in your stomach or whatever it is, it might hurt you more than it helps you. But if you start nourishing yourself, and those cravings that you get as well when you're running ragged are very much for the junk food, but I think it's more for the electrolytes and whatever is in bone broth that you're really craving. So when you go for that instead, it's such a massive difference in how you feel. And it's actually, in terms of bang for the buck, calorie wise, you know, especially if you're like out in Hollywood and trying to stay lean, it's different. But some of the best bang for the buck when you're talking about getting nutrition and protein specifically with a pretty low amount of calories.
Yeah, no, it is a great bang for your buck in that regard with the high protein count, the low calories. And if you could just convince yourself to reach for that in those moments, like you said, it will curb cravings. So you just need to get to that point.
So let's talk about how you made that transition from Hollywood into the food business, because there are probably more people than ever are looking at their lives and looking at what they do day to day for work and making changes, being like, I don't know if this is what I want to keep doing. Maybe I'll switch. But it seems super gutsy to go from being an actress into the food business, especially like food almost / supplement business in some ways, right? Which are some of the most competitive, really difficult. Like if you want to build a business, there are way easier things to build than that. So I'd be curious about your experience kind of shifting careers into something that it seems like you really love now.
Yeah. So that was wild in itself. And I have to say, this sounds totally crazy. But I think that my whole acting career has completely helped me in a lot of ways. Like one, I love speaking, public speaking, great. And in many ways, what I've come to realize is in the acting business, you are the product. You are marketing yourself, saying, hi, I'm so-and-so, nice to meet you. And it's part relationship, it's part being a skill set with great acting skills. It's part luck and timing. So with the bone broth, it's almost exactly the same thing, except less personal. Because it's not about me, it's about this product. So it's the same thing, except, you know, you have a great product, right? Just like acting skills, you have a great product, get it in front of the right people, you reach the right customer bases. So I ended up drawing a lot of parallels to it, except now this acting has given me a platform. It's helped me with social media to pivot it to the bone broth. It's helped me to be really scrappy, I have to say, you know, especially getting started with photo shoots, like for the product and what have you, and cooking videos and everything like that. I have a list of contacts for that will be helpful, do favors. So it helped me be really, really scrappy. And at the same time, it was really daunting because initially, like, I couldn't talk to you about gut health. I just knew that it fixed my digestive issues. So I had a lot to learn. And coming from the acting background, I'm like, I don't want people to think that, you know, that like that I, you know, I want them to trust me and trust my opinion on it. So it took me a lot of work to really know the ins and outs of bone broth other than I loved it. It worked for me. So there was a big learning curve there and very tough. You know, I knew nothing about the USDA, let me tell you, and a supply chain and everything. But I was feeling very, I was doing acting for about 8 years. And like I said, at the time I discovered bone broth, I was getting really bad brain fog and it'd make me go through bouts of feeling unmotivated and feeling a lack of purpose that I think sometimes people go through, especially in the creative industry. So it gave me a lot of clarity, bone broth. And it just so happens that this was the thing I saw a need in the market for. So not only did it give me clarity, but it made me create a company based off of it. And definitely a big risk, but a really rewarding one. I like to tell people nothing bad could happen. People get really, really scared about money, timing, failure. And at the end of the day, if you can't bet on yourself, who can you bet on? And you have one life. So if you're not fulfilled in whatever you're doing, I mean, just give everything a shot. You could always, you'll always find a way to survive and make money. We are, survival is like our most primal state of mind. So at the end of the day, you will figure it out. And it's better a life worth living where you could be fulfilled than the alternative, in my opinion.
But it takes some time and some grinding to get there probably, right? Like, well, how much grinding, how many months or years of grinding did it take before you felt like, oh, I built something and now I can get it out there?
It took me about 2 years to get it off the ground. And then year one, what, since like launching, we're about one year, 4 months since launch. It was a lot of grinding and you just have to be like a bit shameless and reach out to people. Like I like to say at the beginning of this journey, building the company, I don't know if you're familiar with the video game Zelda, but every time, love Zelda. But basically every time she needed a piece of information, she would find the person, ask them, she'd get the piece she was missing. At the beginning of starting this company, I would just put it out there and tell everyone, this is what I'm doing. I call it manifestation, whatever you want, but putting it out there, A, not only made it really real for me and held me accountable, but B, it was like Zelda, where you would get information from sources you didn't even know had information. You were just creating a conversation and putting it out into the world. And then since launch, since we had the product live, it's a bit of the same where, you know, you have some dream people, you want to try it or see it or carry it. So I like to say no ask, no get, like reach out. If they don't answer you, they don't answer you, but that's the worst case scenario. They're not going to like think you're like weird or something. You just have to go for it and grind and hustle and make it happen and knock on as many doors as possible. And in this day and age, doors is inboxes.
Right, right. Well, it's interesting. Now that you said that, I'm thinking about all the entrepreneurs I know who actually started off as artists in their career, whether it was with their own band, being a musician like me, or like you being an actress, putting yourself out there. And when you do work in these creative fields, I think a lot of people don't realize, especially from the outside looking in, how entrepreneurial it is or how many skills you can actually build working in that way, if only being rejected over and over again, which you're, you know, if you go to business school and you're all trained up on systems and you're like, here's my degree and all this, like, why don't you just say yes to me? Because that's not how it works. And artists know that.
No, and by the way, that's exactly it. I'm so used to rejection over and over the slaps. I just don't care. So if someone says no, cool. And I think that the creative industry definitely is very entrepreneurial. You're completely right. And the being prepped for rejection is actually a skill set of its own.
It is. But not generally taught in school. Because that's not something that you can learn about in the book. You need to feel the sting of that over and over until the sting starts to go away, right?
It's true. No, it's true. You do not learn that in school.
What about, are there any other nuggets from working in Hollywood or on big movies or on set that you learned about health that you keep with you now in terms of experience?
Yeah. So I would binge eat a lot. Like they have craft stations on every film set that are open all day during production hours. And so you just binge, right? You're bored. There's a lot, it's hurry up to wait, right? There's like a ton of downtime when you're on a set. So people get bored and they just graze. And then there's the weird hours. Sometimes I would go to work at 6 p.m. and wrap at 6 a.m. So you will do whatever it takes to stay awake. And you're at that craft station being like, oh, M&Ms, it's for work. It's to keep me awake. Oh, this, that, the other, chips. Oh, it will just keep my energy up. So there's a lot of binge eating is what I learned. And that's exactly where the brain fog came from for me. So that's something I took away from me that, you know, you'll kind of do whatever it takes to stay awake and, you know, get the job done successfully. Where if I wish I had a product like mine, I would be drinking it on those night shoots, right? Instead of, hitting up the candy station at Crafty's.
Yeah. Well, and it, for people who haven't really used bone broth in that way, there's a good chance that whatever they were drinking instead or whatever they're drinking instead now is way worse than what drinking bone broth would be. And I'm just thinking about caffeine, even in particular. A lot of people like putting fat in the coffee and that'll keep the energy up and that'll, and me as well. I mean, I like that, especially early in the day, but not so good in the middle of the night, right? Like, especially if you have to sleep afterwards. There are a lot of things that supposedly will fill you up or give you a hit of energy that you can drink. And almost all of them are bad for you. Almost all of them will be borrowing from your future self in some negative kind of way. So if you do preempt that and you have a high quality source of protein and nourishment, or even just something that kind of entertains your mouth, right? Like something that, like, I'm bored, I need something to eat or drink. Bone broth is hard to go wrong with.
Totally. No, it's true. It's literally a boredom thing.
Yeah, well, it is. And so that's where so many people get into trouble, because you start to abuse these foods, right? Like, oh, just a little handful of M&Ms that'll keep me up. It's only 15. It doesn't really add up. And then you come back, you know, a half hour later, and it's like, oh, I'll have some more M&Ms. Like, then they start to crave themselves over time, right? And then the next time you're in the middle of the night and doing a shoot all night long, it's like, where are those freaking M&Ms? I need them now.
Yes, this is very, very true.
What else? We've got a couple minutes left here. What else can we bring from your prior career that people might not understand into the world of health that still serves you very well?
It's a
mysterious world you worked in for a while for a lot of people.
Oh, gosh, it really is. I think one thing I really struggled with, too, that I would try to make as normal as possible for myself is a lack of routine. So, you know, it's a bit of whiplash, because you'll go from working and then all of a sudden, okay, that's a wrap. It's over. And not only do you have the best intentions of keeping in touch with everyone because it becomes your little work family, but now you're unemployed. So then, you know, it's back to auditioning. And then there's sometimes you're getting a lot of auditions, sometimes where it's slow. And so then it's about keeping a routine, right? So I do acting classes, working out, and, you know, do the grind of visiting agents for auditions and stuff. So I think what I brought into this wellness world is creating more of a routine for myself and more of a structure. I'm definitely like a creative person where I don't think personally I could work in an office 9 to 5 just because I have the attention span of a goldfish. But creating a routine for me where it's habitual, it feels like the feeling of home, right? Having a routine. So that's something I definitely brought with me, because it is a really weird place with not a ton of structure, and it is what you make of it, just like you said, very entrepreneurial. So that's another thing I put a lot of value on.
And having that, getting used to a lack of structure can be very useful in a lot of ways, especially if you do go down that entrepreneurial path. And it's either extremely frustrating and exhausting or kind of liberating to be able to go from grinding on one thing to grinding on something completely different that feels like a break from the other thing, right? Like when you're an entrepreneur, you can kind of do that.
Yeah. So, you know, sure, I now have this bone broth company. We have our website, we have our sales, I have the different teams, but I effectively make my schedule every day. So I like that. I like having every day different making schedules, but I still have my routine in the morning that I don't jeopardize no matter what goes on in my day. And I have my wind downs at night.
Real quick, before we go, what is that morning routine? I'm curious.
So non-negotiable, I have to take my dogs somewhere to get coffee. I like the act of
wait, you go to get coffee or the dogs get coffee?
we both do. We go together. So I'll have coffee machines and stuff. I don't want it. I want the act of going to get coffee, ideally walking there, depending on where I am. It's just great for my headspace. And then I work out, then I just do all like my little basic things, my smoothie, my bone broth. And then at nighttime, I like to either paint, play Fortnite, and take a bath, nice. Wind down.
That's a good wind down. Does Fortnite help you wind down or does that wind you up?
Okay. It doesn't help me wind down. In fact, it's a little bit of an issue because it keeps me pumped up. But after work wind down, so not quite before bed.
That's what we do too. We really love playing co-op split screen games, my wife and I, as a way to...
Wait, do you guys play Fortnite?
We don't really play Fortnite. I have a little bit, but I've been waiting for someone to pull me into it. We mostly play RPGs like Divinity. Please. But yeah, we could get into it. My wife, Allison, used to play Halo professionally. She was a pro video gamer and toured all around doing first-person shooters. So I haven't like had her play Fortnite yet. Who knows? We could get horribly addicted.
And they just took away, this is ironic, they just took away building forts, which is ironic because people got too good at it and people were losing interest. And it's way better without the fort building. And I play with my boyfriend like all the time. I got him into it. So if you guys are playing, we can play.
All right. Yeah, we should all hop on. That sounds like a good way to wind down at the end of the day. It's a great way, you know, not that playing video games all the time is great for everyone, but I do find that after that grind, after working all day, it's really important to somehow switch into some other mode. You can play piano, you can play guitar, you can go for a walk, you can paint, but you can also play video games and get yourself into that fun, playful mindset again. Well, that's a great way. And so what is the best place to find Beauty in the Broth, your company, your work, and everything you're going to be doing next?
So the best place to find Beauty in the Broth is thebeautyinthebroth.com or at thebeautyinthebroth. And there we're constantly posting, putting up blogs of what's to come, and where you could find us other than our website, if you prefer to go in person and get it. And you could find me at Melissa Boloña, and you can find Fortnite on Xbox.
Awesome. Okay. We'll see you on Fortnite. Melissa, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Oh, amazing. Thank you so much, Abel. This is great.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay, don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.